Yep, sure. Entertain for the next few hours. Till about 9 o'clock. So, Genesis, let's go to 45, I believe, is where we left off. We finished chapter 45 a couple of weeks ago before we headed overseas. So, just as a review, Joseph had been sold into slavery by his brothers. His father had sent him to his brothers, and he had been sold into slavery by his brothers and taken to Egypt. And we discussed his ups and downs in Egypt. And now he has finally risen to the most powerful man in the kingdom, except for Pharaoh himself. He's second in authority only to Pharaoh. He had been, matter of fact, he was given Pharaoh's signet ring, which means he had the authority of Pharaoh. So all the authority of Pharaoh was bestowed on Joseph. And of course, we're looking at this in context of Joseph being a type or a shadow type of Jesus. So many of the things that Joseph does and the things that happens in Joseph's life happen to Joseph in order that the nation of Israel and us would recognize the Messiah when he comes, because the Messiah would do many of these same things, albeit on a spiritual level, where Joseph does them on a physical level. So on the spiritual level, when Jesus says, "All authority has been given to me," the Father has given all authority to Jesus, just as Pharaoh gave all physical authority to Joseph. So that's how you need to look and approach the story of Joseph. And that's what we're going to continue to do. And so his brothers finally come, and his brothers finally recognize him, and his brothers finally repent of their sins, and Joseph forgives them and welcomes them and brings them to Egypt. Long story short, he brings the whole mess of them to Egypt. 70 people come to Egypt. That's the totality of the people that come with Israel when Joseph brings them to Egypt, which is chapter 46. So when you read it, so Israel, chapter 46, verse 1, so Israel took his journey with all that he had and came to Beersheba and offered sacrifices to the God of his father, Isaac. And God spoke to Israel in visions of the night and said, "Jacob, Jacob," remember Jacob and Israel, same person. God renames him Israel, but his first name was Jacob. "Jacob, Jacob," and he said, "Here I am." Then he said, "I am God, the God of your father. Do not be afraid to go down to Egypt, for there I will make you a great nation. I myself will go down with you to Egypt, and I will bring you up again. And Joseph's hand shall close your eyes." So Joseph wants to bring him back to Egypt. And God has to tell Jacob or Israel that it's okay, that this is God's purpose. He's going to make a great nation of him in Egypt. And this is how the children of Israel enter into Egypt. And of course, later in the story, we see that they're enslaved by the Egyptians, and then God sends Moses to rescue them. That's the story of the Exodus. But this is the story of how they get to Egypt, the nation of Israel. So God tells Israel to go to Egypt. So they go to Egypt. Then in chapter 46, beginning of verse 8, we get the descendants. And this is one of those boring parts of the scripture. When you come to do your scripture reading, if you're reading straight through and you come to all these names, these are the descendants of Israel, the descendants of Jacob. And so we're going to skip those because, number one, that's a lot of reading. Number two, I can't pronounce half of the name or more. So verse 26, all the persons, belonging to Jacob who came into Egypt, who were his own descendants, not including Jacob's sons' wives, were 66 persons in all. And the sons of Joseph who were born to him in Egypt were 2. And all the persons of the house of Jacob who came into Egypt were 70. So 70 Israelites come to the land of Egypt. We see 400 years later, when Moses leads them out of Egypt, there's a vast multitude. So God does indeed make them a great nation while they're in Egypt. Because before they're enslaved, they're settled in the best land in Egypt. right? They're settled in the Nile Delta on the east side of the Nile Delta is the land that Pharaoh gave to Joseph and his family to settle in, which was very fertile land. So they prospered. They prospered well. And he sent Judah ahead of him to Joseph to show the way before him into Goshen. And when they came into the land of Goshen, that's the land I was talking about, Goshen. If you look at the map of Egypt, you know, you've got the Nile River and then it fans out. I guess we all studied this in school a long time ago. It fans out to form the Nile Delta. The land of Goshen is the eastern side of the Nile Delta, right? So it's the eastern side of that. Very fertile land. That's the land of Goshen. Then Joseph prepared his chariot and went up to meet Israel, his father, in Goshen. He presented himself to him and fell on his neck and wept on his neck a good while. Israel said to Joseph, "Now let me die, since I have seen your face, and I know that you are still alive." And Joseph said to his brothers and to his Pharaoh, his father's household, "I will go up and tell Pharaoh and will say to him, 'My brothers and my father's household, who are in the land of Canaan, have come to me. And the men are shepherds, for they have been keepers of livestock, and they have brought their flocks and their herds and all that they have. When Pharaoh calls you and says, "What is your occupation?" you shall say, "Your servants have been keepers of livestock from our youth, even until now, both we and our fathers, in order that you may dwell in the land of Goshen, for every shepherd is an abomination to the Egyptians." So right off the bat, Joseph is separating them from the Egyptians. He wants to keep them, through God's prompting, he wants to keep them a separate people. So he says, when Pharaoh asks what your occupation is, you tell him you're shepherds. You've always been shepherds. And he says the reason is because shepherds are an abomination. They were unclean to the Egyptians, right? They weren't looked upon. It was a necessary occupation, but they tended to use slaves or whoever they could get, or foreigners, to keep their own flocks, because they did not want and did not want to associate with shepherds. So if you're wondering what Joseph is doing here by instructing them to tell Pharaoh what their occupation was, which was shepherds, it was so that they could settle separately from the Egyptians. And that's what they do. That's how God preserved his people from commingling with the people of the land while they were in exile in Egypt. Okay? That's what God also tells us to do, is it not? To separate ourselves from the Egypt that we find ourselves in, to be separate, to be in the world but not of the world. That's what Joseph is doing here when he tells them to tell Pharaoh they are shepherds. In verse chapter 47, so Joseph went in and told Pharaoh, "My father and my brothers, with their flocks and herds and all that they possess, have come from the land of Canaan. They are now in the land of Goshen." And from among his brothers, he took five men and presented them to Pharaoh. Pharaoh said to his brothers, "What is your occupation?" They said to Pharaoh, "Your servants are shepherds, as our fathers were." They said to Pharaoh, "We have come to sojourn in the land, for there is no pasture for your servants' flocks, for the famine is severe in the land of Canaan. And now, please let your servants dwell in the land of Goshen." Then Pharaoh said to Joseph, "Your father and your brothers have come to you. The land of Egypt is before you. Settle your father and your brothers in the best of the land. Let them settle in the land of Goshen. And if you know any able men among them, put them in charge of my livestock." So not only are they going to watch their own flocks, they're going to watch and be in charge of Pharaoh's flocks. And then Joseph brought in Jacob, his father, and stood him before Pharaoh. And Jacob blessed Pharaoh. And Pharaoh said to Jacob, "How many are the days of the years of your life?" And Jacob said to Pharaoh, "The days of the years of my sojourning are 130 years. Few and evil have been the days of the years of my life, and they have not attained to the days of the years of the life of my fathers in the days of their sojourning." And Jacob blessed Pharaoh and went out from the presence of Pharaoh. Then Joseph settled his father and his brothers and gave them a possession in the land of Egypt, in the best land, in the land of Ramses, as Pharaoh had commanded. And Joseph provided his father, his brothers, and all his father's household with food according to the number of their dependents. Thus, that's the story of how the nation of Israel comes to reside in Egypt. And it also sets the stage by how well they were treated and by the land that they were given to settle in, as to why, when there was a change in the dynasty in Egypt. So this is a little historical background that you may not be familiar with. The nation of Israel comes as honored guests and are offered to settle in Egypt by Pharaoh, the Pharaoh who had raised Joseph up. And the internal politics and the war and strife of those days, later, that dynasty was overthrown and a new Pharaoh, a new dynasty, took power in Egypt. One who did not know Joseph, did not know about Joseph, did not know about the Hebrews. And they looked at how powerful the Hebrews had become. They looked at how powerful the children of Israel and wealthy the children of Israel and numerous the children of Israel had become, because this Pharaoh granted them such a place in Egypt, such a privileged place in Egypt, such a privileged land in Egypt, that they had prospered above their neighbors. And so when the new Pharaoh comes on the scene and the new dynasty comes on the scene, they're afraid of these Israelites because they're a mighty nation now, right? There's a few million of them. There are a couple million of them. So the solution to keep the Israelites from siding with the faction they had just defeated was to enslave them. If you're wondering why the Israelites became slaves in Egypt when they started out as honored guests, it's because a new dynasty replace the old dynasty. And in order to keep the Israelites and their men from joining and fighting the new dynasty, they enslaved them. So you probably didn't even care about that. Maybe Chris did. But that's a little historical background of why the nation of Israel ends up as slaves when we turn, a couple pages over and we're in Exodus and Pharaoh's oppressing the Israelites. Well, it's a different dynastic ruler during those intervening years. So, questions so far. Now, we will, what time is it? We got a little bit. Now, remember what caused Pharaoh to raise Joseph up to the position he was. Remember Pharaoh's dreams? Right? And Joseph comes along and says, look, Pharaoh, there's going to be 7 years of plenty followed by 7 years of famine. So here's what you should do, Pharaoh. You should take a percentage during the seven bountiful years and put them aside for the seven lean years. And so that's what Pharaoh puts Joseph in charge of and ultimately raises him up to do everything. And now we're in the midst of the famine. So the rest of chapter 47 is about Joseph's actions in the famine towards the people. Now there was no food in all the land, verse 13, for the famine was very severe, so that the land of Egypt and the land of Canaan languished by reason of the famine. And Joseph gathered up all the money that was found in the land of Egypt and the land of Canaan in exchange for grain that they bought. And Joseph brought the money into Pharaoh's house. And when the money was all spent in the land of Egypt and in the land of Canaan, all the Egyptians came to Joseph and said, give us food. Why should we die before your eyes? For our money is gone. And Joseph answered, give your livestock, and I will give you food in exchange for your livestock, if your money is gone. So they brought their livestock to Joseph, and Joseph gave them food in exchange for the horses, the flocks, the herds, the donkeys, and he supplied them with food in exchange for all their livestock that year. When the year was ended, they came to him the following year and said, we will not hide from my lord that our money is all spent. The herds of livestock are my lord's. There is nothing left in the sight of my lord but our bodies and our land. Why should we die before your eyes, both we and our land? Buy us and our land for food. And we with our land will be servants to Pharaoh, and give us seed that we may live and not die, so that the land may not be desolate. So Joseph bought all the land of Egypt for Pharaoh, for all the Egyptians sold their fields because of the famine was severe on them. The land became Pharaoh's and the people. As for the people, he made servants of them from one end of Egypt to the other. Only the land of the priest he did not buy, for the priest had a fixed allowance from Pharaoh and lived on the allowance that Pharaoh gave them. Therefore, they did not sell their land. Then here's what I want you to notice, verse 23. Then Joseph said to the people, "Behold, I have this day bought you and your land for Pharaoh. Now here is seed for you, and you shall sow the land." We have talked about this. I know I have talked about this, that our approach to evangelism oftentimes is wrong. We approach evangelism like we're off making an offer, when in fact, it's a command to submit to Christ because he has bought us, right? Just as Joseph bought it, because this seems kind of harsh on the surface, doesn't it? Joseph had saved up all his food to save the people. Okay, well, I'll sell it to you. So he takes all the money and gives it to Pharaoh. Well, they've lost their, they don't have any more money, so they bring their livestock. Okay, I'll give you grain in exchange for your livestock. In other words, I want everything. I want everything to present to Pharaoh, just as Jesus wants everything from us to present to God. And finally, Joseph said, "Behold, today, this day, I have bought you. I now own you. You will be servants of Pharaoh." And then what does Joseph tell him to do? Here's the means, here's the things that you need to go out there and be fruitful. It's the very same thing that Jesus does for us, right? Jesus demands our submission. He demands that we acknowledge that he is Lord and Savior. Not just Savior, but Lord and Savior. He is my Lord. He owns everything I have. I know we speak those words all the time, don't we? Everything I have is the Lord, right? He gives me my job. He gives me my health. He gives me whatever. But then I want to use it not for his purposes, not for his glory. I want to use it on Jeff. Well, that's not right. And we give lip service to it, but in reality, our lives don't reflect the fact that he owns me, lock, stock, and barrel. He owns every cent I own belongs to him. Everything I have belongs to him. And I should be willing to use it for him. That's what's going on here. Yes, Chris.
Yeah, so it might have been like 2 or 3 weeks ago, but I was listening to a sermon on the way to work, and I can't remember the pastor's name. I can get it to you if you're interested. I could send you the clip, but he talks about how when he went to college, he got a full ride scholarship for football, and he talks about how everything was free and how the college was free, the food was free, the lodging was free, all these things. But ultimately, his participation in accepting that scholarship cost him everything. Mm-hmm. Now, all of a sudden, he was dictated how to live his life. He had a curfew, football programs, everything.
Where to be, yeah.
Yeah, and then he draws that parallel to salvation. And he said the same exact thing. He's like, salvation is also free, but it's going to cost you everything.
Everything.
And like he goes on a tangent about just what it means to be a true Christian up into giving your life if it's necessary. And it was Vonnie Bachman, a beautiful analogy.
It wasn't Vonnie Bachman. Was it Vonnie Bachman?
It wasn't Vonnie, but it was on that 21st Century Revival channel that shows like Paul Washer, Vonnie, and a couple of the other Baptist preachers.
Yeah.
And it was one of those guys. I'll send you the link.
All right. Yeah, but and that's what's going on here. But notice that Joseph, he says, "Yes, I have bought you. You are now servants of Pharaoh. Now here's some seed. Go out there and sow it. Here's the means by which you are to be fruitful." It's the very same thing that Jesus does to us. He has bought me by his blood. He has bought me, and we've talked about this many times. What is the purpose of my salvation? It's to ultimately glorify God. I'm not saved to glorify Jeff. I'm saved to show the glory of God and the grace of God and the majesty of God. And then he gives me the means by which I am to go back out into the fields and sow my seed and produce fruit for him. That's what Joseph is doing. Here's your seed. You go produce fruit for Pharaoh. Yes, you're going to eat from it. It's going to support you, but a portion of it is going to belong to Pharaoh, just as a portion of what God grants to us belongs to him, and we are to give back. And on down in verse 25, and they said, "You have saved our lives. May it please my Lord, we will be servants to Pharaoh." So they're very grateful for what Joseph has done to them. He has saved their lives by his actions. And not only has he saved their lives, he has gathered the means by which he can help support them. All that livestock was not walking around Pharaoh's palace. They would still need places to put them in the field. They would still need shepherds to watch them, right? They would still benefit from those livestock, but ultimately they belonged to Pharaoh. Pharaoh had a claim on them, just as Pharaoh had a claim on their lands and Pharaoh had a claim on their life, because Joseph saved their life by the bread. So questions there. All right. Chapter 48, we have the story of Jacob blessing Joseph's children. Now, when you read the names of the 12 tribes of Israel, when you see the list of the 12 tribes in Israel, sometimes they have different names on them. Sometimes Ephraim is listed, sometimes Manasseh is listed, sometimes Joseph is listed, and Ephraim is listed. Those three are synonymous. Manasseh and Ephraim are the children of Joseph, right? They're included in the 12 tribes of Israel because of what happens here in chapter 48. When Jacob/Israel tells Joseph, you can have the children after these, but these two are mine. These two belong to me. They are included in my sons. They're getting a birthright from me, not from you. I'm sure there's some deep theological issues that cause this to happen. I've yet to discover them. But Jacob says to Joseph, when Joseph brings Manasseh and Ephraim to meet their grandfather, to come in before their grandfather, and their grandfather is going to bless them. And he switches his hands, you can read it. He switches his hands, puts his right hand, which is the hand that's supposed to go on the elder son. He puts it on Ephraim's head, and he puts this one on Manasseh's head, and Joseph tries to fix it. And Jacob says, no, this is what I'm doing. I know what I'm doing, because the older will serve the younger. And so you look at the nation of Israel's history, and you see that Ephraim does become greater than Manasseh. So Ephraim is often listed as a 12th tribe of Israel instead of Joseph or Manasseh. And you're probably glazing over by now, wondering what does all this mean. I'm just simply saying that chapter 48 is the story of the blessing of Manasseh and Ephraim and explains why they are included in the listing of the 12 tribes of Jacob, or the 12 tribes of Israel. Remember, they're the 12 children of Jacob, when in fact they are Joseph's children. And it is because his father Jacob said, these two are mine, you can have what comes after these. You can have to leave your legacy to after these. But these are part of the 12 tribes of Israel. That's why chapter 48 is in there. And in chapter 49, we have Jacob blessing his sons. We won't go into all of them, but I do want to look at verses 10. Well, let's look at verse 8 and following. This is the blessing of Judah, right? He blesses Reuben, but you will not be preeminent in dignity and preeminent in power. You're unstable as water, and you shall not have preeminence because you went up to your father's bed and you defied it. He went up to my couch. You can go back in Genesis and read about what Reuben does with one of the concubines. And in Simeon and Levi, they are not given prominence because after the defiling of Dinah, their sister, they trick the men of the village of the man who defiled their sister but wanted to marry their sister. He was in love with their sister. And they said, you need to get circumcised and we'll let you marry your sister, you and the whole village. And so when they had been circumcised, then Levi and Simon went in there and killed them all. So Jacob says, all right, your curse be their anger, for it is fierce, and their wrath, for it is cute. I will divide them in Jacob and scatter them in Israel. They're not going to be the leaders of the family either. That brings us to the next son, Judah. Judah Your brother shall praise you. Your hand shall be on the neck of your enemies. Your father's sons shall bow down before you. Judah is a lion's club. From the prey, my son, you have gone up. He stooped down. He crouched as a lion and as a lioness who dares rouse him. The scepter shall not depart from Judah, nor the ruler's staff from between his feet until tribute comes to him, and to him shall be the obedience of the people. Here we have a prophecy where we're narrowing down where the Messiah will come from, right? First of all, we know he's coming through Adam. That didn't do Noah. And then he separates Abraham. Abraham, I'm going to give you a child of the promise. And through that child of the promise, which was Isaac, all of the nations of the world will be blessed. So we narrowed it down to Abraham, the seed of Abraham. Furthermore, since Abraham had more of the children, it's the seed of Isaac and Jacob, now named Israel. Now we narrow down further until ultimately we're going to get to the lineage of David, right? But here we are narrowing it down to the tribe of Judah. So here in Genesis chapter 49 is where we are told that the Messiah will come from the tribe of Judah, not from the tribe of Reuben, even though he was the eldest, not from the tribe of Levi, Simeon, Dan, any of the others, from the tribe of Judah. And he is equated with a lion, which is why we call him the Lion of the tribe of Judah, from right here. So this is where it's a further narrowing down of the lineage of the Messiah and showing the people when it comes, yes, he is of the tribe of Judah. Jesus was of the tribe of Judah. Well, that comes from right here. Then in verse 22, Joseph is called a fruitful branch or bough in my ESV, but it's the word for branch. Just like Jesus is called the righteous branch. He's also called in verse 24, from there is the shepherd and the stone of Israel. It's talking about Joseph here, right? So in other words, Joseph has been standing in for these positions that Jesus will ultimately fulfill. So any questions? But you can go back and read the blessings of all the sons.
Actually, I do, Jeff. So you said Manasseh and Ephraim were actually sons of Joseph and not Jacob, but then Jacob took them as if they were his?
Yes.
I mean, hear me out on this one. It's just a shot in the dark here, but because you said you didn't understand like the theological meaning behind that, but what I see is although they were not direct descendants, well, they weren't the sons of Jacob. He took them in as if they were anyway and claimed it.
Yeah.
So therefore, the Jewish argument that Jesus can't be from the line of David because he wasn't the direct son of them is irrelevant because Joseph took in Jesus as his son, even though he wasn't the biological father of them, in the same way that Jacob took in Manasseh and Ephraim as his son, even though he wasn't the biological father.
There may be something to that.
Because, I mean, at the formation of the 12 tribes of Israel, you have the same principle.
Yeah.
Just something, I literally just thought of it right then when you were spitting that.
That may be, I'm not sure.
Because it's almost as if, you know, like God was showing them right there when he's forming the 12 tribes of Israel, that principle, and then it would come into play later with Jesus and Joseph.
Yeah. So in chapter 48, verse 3, and Jacob said to Joseph, God Almighty appeared to me at Luz in the land of Canaan and blessed me and said to me, behold, I will make you fruitful and multiply you, and I will make of you a company of peoples, and will give this land to your offsprings after you for an everlasting possession. And now your two sons, Ephraim and Manasseh, who were born to you in the land of Egypt before I came to you in Egypt, are mine. Ephraim and Manasseh shall be mine as Reuben and Simeon are. And the children that you fathered after them shall be yours. They shall be called by the name of their brothers in their inheritance. As for me, when I come from Paddan, to my sorrow, Rachel died, and so on and so forth. So right there at the very first chapter 48, he says, yeah, these two are mine. They shall be just like Reuben and Simeon to me. You can have the ones afterwards. So yeah, you may be right, be onto something, that it sets a precedent about adoption and how they are legally now Jacob's children, and they would share in Jacob's inheritance, right? So just as Jesus was legally Joseph's son, although there was no blood tie there. Interesting stuff. And then we are recorded for us in the latter part of chapter 49, Jacob's death and burial. And then in chapter 50, we have a further reconciliation of Joseph and his brothers, because his brothers are now suddenly frightened again because their dad's gone. Daddy's gone. Daddy has died. Now maybe Joseph's going to get mad at us again. So they come once again and confess their sins to him, right? And fall prostrate before him. And this is what Joseph says in chapter 20, in verse 20. As for you, no. Verse 19. But Joseph said to them, do not fear, for I am in the place of God. For am I in the place of God? As for you, you meant evil against me, but God meant it for good, to bring it about that many people should be kept alive as they are today. So do not fear, I will provide for you and your little ones. And thus he comforted them and spoke kindly to them. Then the book of Genesis closes out that Joseph died in Egypt at 110 years old. And they embalmed him, and he was put into a coffin in Egypt after he made him promise to bring his bones back when they come. So that's the book of Genesis, and I don't know where we're going next week, but we'll figure something out. Questions, comments, concerns?